This is Radio Ecoshock with Alex Smith.
You may believe climate disruption is arriving sooner than we were told. You are right. Three powerhouse scientists have published a warning: global warming will happen faster than we think. They explain three emerging threats that combine to bring climate danger out of that year 2100 and right into the next decade. Our guide to the comment, published by the prestigious journal Nature, is co-author David G. Victor. At the University of California, San Diego, Dr. Victor is a professor of international relations and director of the Laboratory on International Law and Regulation. He is a connected guy, often producing reports for the Brookings Institution while publishing articles in magazines like The New Yorker. David Victor is the author of the book Global Warming Gridlock, published by Cambridge University Press. David Victor, welcome to Radio EcoShock.
It's great to be here. Thank you.
Let's go straight to this important new article in Nature. You were teamed up with co-author Ram Ramanathan from the Scripps Institution of Oceanography. He's one of the gods of science to me. And the lead author is the brilliant young scientist from Texas A&M, Dr. Yang Zhu. And David, what brought you three together, and is there an urgency behind your message?
Well, what brought us together was Yang's PhD. He was a student of ours at the Scripps Institution of Oceanography, where I'm also an adjunct professor. And Ram Ramanathan and I, over the years, have written a lot of things together, do a lot of projects together, advise students together. And Yang was one of our students and one of our sharpest students. And he's a terrific climate modeler. And what brought us together on this particular story was the observation that the new IPCC report, this is the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the UN body that assesses climate science, that new report had warned of the risks of rapid warming, and it suggested that we might get to 1.5 degrees of warming by 2040 or beyond. We looked at that and thought that's actually maybe even not pessimistic or worrisome enough, that when you look at the underlying data, as we've done now in this new Nature comment, that the rate of warming is even faster than the IPCC had warned. And that's what got us together working on this and led us to write this article.
And in November, the world's top medical journal, Lancet, published their 2018 report on health and climate change. And that seems to reinforce the idea that we're already hotter. People are experiencing it by the hundreds of millions.
Yeah, exactly. And in fact, Ram Ramanathan and I and several people involved with the Pontifical Academy of Sciences had an article in Foreign Affairs, the foreign policy journal, foreignaffairs.com, earlier last year, that laid out all the evidence that warming is now happening, and including having big impacts on human health. And we're interested in this in part because we're worried about the impacts, and in part because we're concerned about the politics. And we're thinking as the effects of climate change become more tangible, that more people are going to want to do something about it, because it's, you know, frankly, serious political action on climate change is, you know, decades overdue.
So let's focus on those three trends that will, quote, combine over the next 20 years to make climate change faster and more furious than anticipated, end quote. And point one is rising emissions. That is kind of a surprise to us all. Talk to us about that, David.
Yeah, it's interesting. A decade or two ago, the IPCC, the same body that assesses the climate science, put together a set of scenarios for future emissions. And they did, as is typical in this business, they did scenarios where there's no real change in policy, get very high emissions, scenarios where there are various kinds of changes in policy, including scenarios that would bend emissions down, eventually have 50-80% cuts in global emissions, consistent with stopping warming at 2 degrees. And so there's this kind of range of scenarios, because we don't know what's going to happen in the future. What's interesting to me as an analyst of the energy system is that emissions today are basically on track for the highest emission scenarios that were published a decade or two ago, which means that despite all the talking about climate change, there's not a lot of doing. So emissions keep going up. There's a study out just in the last couple of days that U.S. emissions were up, I think, about 2.8% last year, even though they've been declining for more than a decade prior to that. Global emissions are up higher than people expected. There was a study that came out for the same issue of Nature as our article. And so when you take a step back from this, I think it's very important that we have these diplomatic conferences and all this policy activity around climate change. But when you look at the data and the impact on emissions, you're not seeing it.
You know, about 10 years ago, I interviewed the famous climate blogger Joe Rome, and the accepted view then was that climate change would be slow and warming only 0.1 degree per decade, what is the new understanding of how fast Earth will heat up?
Well, the new understanding, which, again, we don't know exactly, but the new understanding is kind of double that rate in that ballpark. And the argument we made in our article was that it's accelerating. So it's not just that it's rising linearly at a rate faster than 0.1 degree, but that the rate itself is growing. And that's what's really concerning here, is you've got an exponential process with lots of uncertainty, risks that the climate system could really get out of control, and that the system is being torqued with these building emissions in the atmosphere, and that's causing exponential changes, not linear changes.
The second trend that you pinpoint in the comment is the partial success by government regulations to reduce air pollution. Surely less smog is good news for our lungs, but how is it also bad news?
Well, most of what you do to address other environmental problems also helps reduce climate change. But in a few areas, they work in opposite directions. And this is one of the areas. There are especially coal-fired power plants, but a variety of other sources, but especially coal-fired power plants emit a lot of pollutants. They emit carbon dioxide, which is what causes climate change. They emit nitrogen oxides, which cause acid rain and local air pollution effects. They emit sulfur dioxide, which causes acid rain, and a variety of other pollutants. Sulfur dioxide is the one that we're talking a lot about in our article. And what happens to sulfur dioxide in the atmosphere is it turns into sulfate particles, which make clouds brighter. And so they actually ironically cool the planet a little bit. And the Chinese know that they've got a huge local air pollution and regional air pollution problem. So they've been investing very heavily in controlling emissions from their coal-fired power plants. They've shut down old inefficient plants, built new kinds of coal-fired power plants with all the latest pollution control equipment, and it's on and operating. And so they've very quickly lowered their emissions of these other pollutants, and that's been really good for Chinese health, and they need to do more, but it's ironically lessened this brightening effect, the mask, if you like, that's existed on climate warming, and that mask has had a large offsetting effect on climate warming. And so as that mask is removed more rapidly than this, almost all the scenarios had predicted, that's contributing to the accelerated warming.
How do scientists know there has been a reduction in air pollution? How do we measure such things?
Well, there's a variety of ways of measuring it. Some pollutants you can measure from satellites. There's a lot of, frankly, on-the-ground work by experts in power plants and other industrial technologies where they go off and look and see what kinds of technologies are installed and try and develop a story as to what is actually going on the ground. Some of these pollutants you can measure downwind. And so you have to put together lots of different data sources to get to this. You know, there's still a lot of uncertainty about Chinese energy statistics. There's still more uncertainty about Chinese CO2 emissions than you would like to have. And so nobody really knows exactly what's going on the ground, I guess, is that even the Chinese government doesn't fully know. But the data picture has improved a lot, and it's all consistent with this story that the Chinese are aggressively trying to clean up their act. I mean, so much so that the air pollution, the kind of legendary air pollution problems in Beijing, although they still exist, they're now being eclipsed by legendary air pollution problems in other countries, and notably in India. I think India is going to be the next big story in this area where there's going to be a need for cleanup and a need for more efficient and less polluting coal plants and alternatives to coal like solar. And that story, though, is still unfolding.
So do we know how much warming is hidden by global dimming or this layer of aerosols in the atmosphere?
Not exactly, but it's on the order of half a degree. And we have in the paper, we have some pointers to some other estimates, but it's something in that range.
So when the IPCC proposes to stay below 2 degrees C warming, and they use dubious carbon capture technology for those scenarios, do they include up to 2/3 of a degree more heating, which will emerge when air pollution is cleaned up?
Well, so there's a separate set of articles, that some of which I've been involved with, that have raised questions about whether we're in fact setting our goals for climate policy in the right way. And this is one of the key points of contention, that right now we talk about goals in terms of globally average temperature. In fact, globally average air temperature near the surface of the Earth. But the reality is that temperature is affected by lots of factors. Some of them are naturally variable in nature, including cycles in the oceans in the Pacific and the Atlantic, which might actually be one of the additional factors that's causing warming. So there's natural variability. And then most of the heat actually does not build up in the atmosphere. It builds up in the oceans. And so a number of us have raised questions about whether we should be looking at other ways of setting global goals that would be more directly related to how humans are affecting the climate and to the policies that humans are adopting to try and control their emissions. And that would make it easier to measure actual progress. Because right now, it's actually very hard to take the pulse of whether we're doing well or poorly with climate policy, because our major indicator is a globally average indicator that's responsive to so many different factors.
You've already raised the third major driver covered in your comment, that faster warming could come because of entering a natural warm phase that could last for a couple of decades. That's probably the hardest for the public to understand. Could you take a couple of minutes to explain why a natural warming may pile on to our greenhouse pollution?
Yeah, there are a lot of different things going on. Let me just talk about one as an illustration. One of the things that people are concerned about is that the circulation of the oceans might change with climate. In fact, probably will change with climate warming. And in the past, it has changed. And so when the circulation speeds up or slows down, that alters how much heat it can be taken out of the surface oceans and put into the deep oceans. And so those are the kinds of natural cycles that could be amplified or slowed down or adjusted as a result of climate warming. And then that, in turn, would have an effect on the globally averaged surface temperature, and therefore would have an effect on whether we're meeting our goals.
David Victor, you have a strange habit of visiting power plants, perhaps even on family vacations. What are you finding lately that you did not see 10 years ago?
Well, I think there are two things that are very interesting. One is that the technology in the power industry is really global, and that began 25, 30 years ago, but it's really accelerated. Today, if you go visit the best power plants in the world, increasingly you're seeing the best technology everywhere. And a lot of that has been an effect in China, where advanced technology has been tested in China, and then Chinese companies have merged around that technology. Now the Chinese are spreading that technology around through initiatives like the Belt and Road Initiative, which is a big outward investment program led by the Chinese government. And so the technology has become global, which means that as we develop better ideas, they come into service much more quickly. And overall, the effect of that has been to probably help slow the growth in emissions, because a lot of these technologies are more efficient. So that's one trend that I think is really, really interesting. The other trend that's interesting is the renewables revolution is happening more quickly than people expected. And I'm skeptical that we can go to all renewables quickly, and very involved with some technical papers to look at the plausibility of that. But there's no question that on the ground, there's a lot more solar and a lot more wind, and that has helped shift away from high carbon fuels to low carbon fuels. I am concerned that people think that we're going to solve the carbon problem entirely with solar and wind, when in reality, we're going to need all technologies. We're going to need advanced nuclear power. There's a lot of new nuclear power being built in China, to some degree in Korea, now even in the Persian Gulf. And so that's, I think, actually a very encouraging trend, where that can be done safely and properly in a cost-effective way. And there might also be a role for carbon capture and storage, where some fossil fuels continue to get used, but the pollution gets captured and put underground before it goes up in the atmosphere. And there's, in particular, an advanced natural gas carbon capture and storage plant being tested right now outside Houston, Texas, that I think is if it works, is going to be very, very important, because there's so much natural gas in the world.
And your paper seems to say that because we're going to have this faster warming, we need a forefront approach. And it seems to begin with a criticism of climate science that perhaps it has been too long-sighted. Could you explain that?
Yeah, so we don't want to take climate scientists completely to task. This is a hard business. There's lots of complexity and uncertainty. But there has been, for almost since the beginning of serious analysis of global warming, there's been an attention on long-term warming, 100-year, sometimes 1,000-year warming, because the models work better in that way. And we can understand the equilibrium and the kind of geophysical adjustments in the climate system as a result of that. So that kind of work is very important. But one of the things we're saying in the article is that because warming is happening now faster, we need to be developing and deploying better tools for understanding shorter-term patterns in warming, and then what can be done to slow down those short-term rates of warming to generate immediate benefits from actions to control pollution. This is one of the areas where Ram Ramanathan in particular has been most well-known, which is the potential for controlling emissions of soot, which is a huge killer in terms of air pollution and also a big contributor to climate warming. And so if you can control soot emissions, that results in very quick impact on the climate. And politically, I think that's very interesting, because it means that the politics controlling soot are easier than the politics of controlling, for example, carbon dioxide, because soot kills people and has their immediate local benefits to less soot, and there are tangible benefits in terms of less climate warming. Whereas one of the reasons why it's been politically hard to make a lot of progress on the climate problem is that the main pollutant is carbon dioxide, and carbon dioxide is invisible, odorless. It essentially causes no other problems other than climate warming and acidification of the oceans. And so it builds up over very long periods of time. And in order to control that pollutant, you have to spend a lot of money today to reduce emissions for benefits that are really only going to accumulate far in the future and mostly in other countries. And so politically, the structure of the carbon dioxide as a pollutant is very inconvenient for making big actions in this area, whereas the politics around controlling soot and controlling a few other pollutants that are shorter lived, those politics are a little more tractable.
Check out the Radio EcoShock website. We're at ecoshock.org.
You are tuned to the world broadcast of Radio EcoShock. I'm Alex Smith with my guest, Professor David G. Victor. We're talking about a new warning: global warming will happen faster than we think. David, you and your co-authors are calling for a new IPCC report. What do we need?
Yeah, we need a report to understand the transition, what rapid warming really means, and how plausibly we can control emissions. My chief criticism, the IPCC just issued a special report last fall on the potential impacts of 1.5 degrees of warming. So a lot of people have been talking for years about 2 degrees of warming. There's a growing evidence that even 2 degrees of warming may cause big impacts. And so the IPCC was asked to look at 1.5 degrees. And so they did that. They came out with this report last fall. And most of that report's great because it provides new science and a new assessment of science around the consequences of 1.5 degrees. But the part of the report that's most kind of incredible is the part of the report that deals with how you could control emissions very quickly to get to 1.5 degrees. And it's incredible because it assumes a whole bunch of technologies come into place very quickly, and then we can rapidly reduce emissions. And that's just not going to happen in the real world. So we need a better assessment of science that's around the real political feasibility of actions.
From the Arctic to India, I see reports that large parts of the world have already warmed past 1.5 degrees C, for most of the year at least. And frankly, I feel the discussion of 1.5 as a target is almost a cruel joke. We will pass that quickly. Why bother with an impossible target?
That's my view as well. We're going to go through 1.5 degrees. So it's been kind of a political rallying point, but I don't see how we're feasibly going to stop warming at 1.5 degrees. And I think that's the new reality of climate change, that if you believe the science that warming is happening faster than people originally expected, and you look in a sober way at the last 30 years, we've been talking a lot but not doing very much. We've got to get ready for a world that's going to be worse than inconveniently, a lot warmer, impacts worse than we expected. That means that climate adaptation is going to be a bigger deal. It means we're going to see more discussions around the concept of geoengineering, which is the idea that you engineer the climate directly to kind of offset in a crude way potential impacts of climate change. And, you know, none of this is attractive. All of it is seriously fraught with problems, but that's the world that we're in right now.
Back in 2008, you published for the Oxford Press a study on how to regulate geoengineering, and it was still a pretty young subject at the time. And when it comes to the control of geoengineering and the protection of everybody's interests, what is the best we can hope for?
I think we don't really know, actually, right now. The 2008 article came out of a scientific conference around geoengineering where literally the entire scientific community working on the topic could fit in one seminar room. And they were there, most of them. Nowadays, a lot more people working on this, and there's a diffusion of the technologies, not a lot of real-world testing. The number one scenario that I'm concerned about is that some rogue nation will say this climate change is happening quickly and it's harming our people. We need to show our people that we're doing something about it, and they're going to go off and do some half-baked geoengineering scheme, a kind of Dr. Strangelove kind of thing, running off and doing this. And then the rest of the world's going to be stuck with the consequences of that because geoengineering systems are hard to localize in one particular place on the planet. And so that's the scenario that really concerns me the most.
Me too. And if the world is warming much faster than we expected, and we get examples of it like the California fires, do you think humans will eventually be forced to shade out some of the sun while we figure out what else to do?
I don't know if we'll be forced. I think that the incentives for some people to do this will go up and possibly go up a lot. This is always going to be enormously controversial. I mean, this is almost playing God with the planet. It's literally taking the thermostat directly in our control and trying to manipulate it. We're doing that right now with the greenhouse gases that are building up in the atmosphere, but that's not a purposeful activity in the sense that people are trying to cause this harm, whereas geoengineering would be purposeful efforts to try and directly manipulate with very quick response the temperature and other attributes of the climate. So I think that's always going to be controversial in some countries. But I think what's going to happen is the incentives for other countries to go off and do this or test this, or, you know, maybe for some rich dude with a convenient island nation at his disposal or her disposal to just go off and start doing some of these things, those incentives are going to go up. And I've written a little bit about this, you know, 10 years or so ago, and thought some of this was kind of science fiction, but interesting. I'd say that it's moving out of the fiction category into some kind of plausible reality.
Yes, Harvard's doing an experiment, but it's only a scientific experiment to see how these materials could be spread out in the atmosphere, and I think that's going to come up this year. We'll see what happens. Now, David Victor, among other things, you are a regulations expert. You can advise governments, but we see governments are failing on climate action, not just in America, but in Brazil now, Poland, Russia, and beyond. Can we maintain a political environment where regulatory approaches could really work?
Well, this is a hard problem. This is plausibly the hardest problem, hardest sustained problem the global community has worried about. And, you know, the conspicuous failures of government, like in the United States, or you mentioned in the case of Brazil under the new government, those failures are conspicuous. But even the countries that have really been leaders in this area are having a hard time. Germany and France, for example. Britain is distracted because of Brexit. Japan has long been a leader in this area, but the Japanese economy is already pretty efficient, and so their capacity to make big reductions in emissions is limited. There's a kind of growing disconnect between what people are saying they're going to do in terms of emissions control and what they're actually going to do. I'm pessimistic about the short term. I think the politics of this is a really, really hard. I'm optimistic over the longer term, in part because the evidence of damage will grow, and in part because of technology, that as the technologies for reducing emissions become better, that makes the politics easier because it makes this a less costly problem. It also creates interest groups that want to deploy technologies, whether it's advanced nuclear reactors or wind and solar. And so those interest groups get organized and they push for more policy. And that's the way we've actually solved most of our environmental problems. It's just that the climate problem has proved to be a much, much harder one to address. And so the solution set has been a much slower coming into place.
Can you give us any examples of what governments could do for rapid adaptation to faster climate change?
One of the things I think is interesting about adaptation to climate change is that politically, it's almost the opposite of controlling emissions. So in controlling emissions, you really need central governments to adopt policies across the entire economy. You spend a ton of money. That affects organized interest groups today, and the benefits are far in the future. Adapting to climate impacts are the exact opposite. Most adaptation is local. It affects, you know, communities that are affected by potential inundation from rising sea levels, extreme storms, wildfires, all those kinds of things. It's mainly a local and to some degree regional planning activity. And whether or not you believe in climate science, if the ocean is rising, you got to do something about it. And so the politics of adaptation are actually going to be easier, I think, than the politics of controlling emissions in the first place. So I think that's the key point here is we're starting to see in the United States, for example, even places that have voters who are most skeptical about climate science, like in Florida, people who voted for Trump and are thrilled that Trump is leaving the Paris Agreement, those are exactly the communities that are on the front lines of climate impacts and are being forced to develop adaptation measures. But there's no silver bullet in adaptation. It's lots of stuff. It's seawalls. It's nourishing sand on beaches. It's moving houses that are in vulnerable areas. It's bigger fire breaks. It's a whole dog's breakfast of activities that you need to do, and they're all bespoke to local conditions.
David Victor, what is your take on the COP24 climate conference in Katowice, Poland in December 2018?
Yeah. I mean, they went there. They had a meeting. They made, it appears, a little bit of progress on what's called the rule book, which are the rules for reporting data and a variety of other things. There was no big deadline there. I would say that the expectations appropriately were very low, and they easily made them because the expectations were low. Now, I think the real problem is it's easy to think that diplomacy can get a lot done in this area, but this is really not a diplomatic problem. It's a leadership problem. It's a problem that requires some countries to go out and do things and show the world, here's how you do it, and then show the world, here's what I promised I would do, here's what I did, here's what I couldn't do. And that's the whole logic of the Paris process, is it gets countries to make their own pledges as to what they're going to do and then follow up on those pledges. And that's a little bit of that is about the rule book and the diplomacy, you know, things like COP24. But most of it is, frankly, about political energy and political focus. And I'm very concerned that the political focus has come off climate change, you know, despite all the evidence, because the world is focused on a lot of other things, you know, trade wars, Brexit, the strange behavior of the United States president, kind of list goes on.
And your article talks about global warming as a speeding freight train. And it feels to me like most people in the developed world are most comfortable staying paralyzed on the tracks. You talk about this in your book, Global Warming Gridlock. Can we break out?
Well, I mean, the difference between this and an actual freight train is in an actual freight train, if you're on the tracks and you see the train coming, you get off the tracks. In our case, we're on the planet, and nobody's leaving the planet. Almost nobody's leaving the planet. So we're there. We got to deal with it. That's the real new politics of climate change, is that the attention to climate impacts, to managing those impacts, to adaptation, potentially to geoengineering, that part of the debate, which used to be peripheral and even taboo not so long ago because people didn't want to take political attention away from controlling emissions, that part of the debate, what we're going to see in the coming years already happening, that part of the debate is going to surge because people are going to be forced to deal with those realities. And some parts of the world, you know, sadly, the countries that are least responsible for causing climate problems, the least developed countries, are the ones that will be most vulnerable to many of the climate impacts, including small island nations, because one way to become more, you know, immune to climate impacts is to become richer and have stronger institutions and better capacity to build public infrastructures. That's all the stuff that these societies have the hardest time doing.
As we wrap up, is there anything else you would like to tell our listeners?
Well, I would like to say one thing, which is there's been a lot of attention to the U.S. government leaving the scene because of the Trump administration, and that's unfortunate, and my guess is that will change, but it'll require new elections. But at the same time, other parts of the U.S. are still there, and I think that's increasingly the story is, to make real progress on the climate change problem requires leadership and jurisdictions that demonstrate here's how to control emissions, here's what it really costs. And that leadership is mostly coming from smaller jurisdictions and not big countries. And in the United States, it's coming from the coastal zones, in particular California, where I live. And you're seeing leadership from individual firms. You're seeing leadership from parts of Canada. You're seeing leadership from lots of places. And so we need to help the leaders do a better job leading, and in particular help the leaders develop strategies that can be easily replicated in other parts of the world, because it's, you know, it just doesn't help for a leader that doesn't emit very much to come up with a fancy way of controlling emissions. They've got to have something that scales ultimately to the globe.
We have been talking with Dr. David G. Victor, Professor of International Relations and Director of the Laboratory on International Law and Regulation at UC San Diego. David is co-author of the paper Global Warming Will Happen Faster Than We Think. You can find links to follow up on all of this in my weekly show blog at ecoshock.org. David Victor, thank you for sharing your valuable time with us.
Well, it's a great pleasure to join you. Thank you.
I'm Alex Smith for Radio Ecoshock.
You're listening to Ecoshock Radio for the world.
I'm Alex Smith. Get it all at our website, ecoshock.org.